Okay, the door is closed. You know what that means. You're stuck here for an hour now. Well, the door really is closed. It doesn't even open if you try. So, welcome. My name is Magnus Hagander. I guess for a lot of you, you're much closer than me. I'm out of Stockholm, so at least I'm from this country, but from the other side that we don't speak about, right? I'm sure there are more West Coasters here than there is me. I'm here today to talk about ACME and the fact that ACME isn't just for rockets anymore. Or as I like to sometimes put it, you know, new ways of blowing things up. There are all these awesome automated ways of breaking things. And this is one of them. But first, a few more words about me. As I said, my name is Magnus Hagander. I work for a company called Redpill Linpro. We're an open source consultancy and services shop. We do actually have an office here in Gothenburg. I'm not in it. I'm in the Stockholm office. I work in our departments for doing infrastructure work. And that department doesn't currently exist in our Gothenburg office. We mostly have developers here, I think mainly focused around Java, but also some other parts of it. My main job in the company is working on Postgres, the open source relational database. But I'm actually not here to talk about Postgres. And for those of you who have seen me give talks at other conferences and things, I usually talk about Postgres. But I'm going to do something else this time. But I am, a lot of what I do is related to Postgres. I'm a member of the Postgres Core Team and one of the code committers, so I work on the code of the actual database server. I'm currently the president of Postgres Europe, and in this regard, the most important part, which is not on here, is that I'm also one of the Postgres.org infrastructure team. The guys who run all the servers that serve the project with everything from, you know, websites to mailing lists and Git servers and continuous integration and all that stuff. And that's really the center of this talk, because this talk is going to center around a small case study, which is basically what we ended up doing for the Postgres infrastructure, and how we ended up doing it in order to make it possible, really, in a case like ours. Because as many open source organizations, the Postgres team is a volunteer organization, which means nobody volunteers to do the boring stuff. But it still has to get done, so you need to figure out a way to automate it. We have a few things that are easy. If you look at the basic environment of what we run, I first gave this talk about half a year ago. At that time, we ran about 65 virtual machines. I think we're a bit above 70 now, but it's sort of on that order of magnitude. It's not thousands. It's also not 10. While it was 10, you could do everything manually. You can't do everything manually when you're hitting 50 plus. If you get to 1,000, you really can't do that, right? We're currently in 5 different data centers in 4 different countries. US, Austria, Sweden, and the Netherlands, and in one cloud. Most of what we do is not in the cloud today, but we do have some nodes in AWS. And we run these 65 VMs, all the sysadmin, all the development, all of it with zero staff. With nobody with dedicated time. We have 4 or 5 people. In reality, we have 4 who are on what we call the infrastructure team. None of them have any dedicated time from their employers to actually work on it, which means it has to take care of itself. You can't really do a lot of things. Now, of course, things go wrong. Somebody has to find the time. That's just how it works. But you really have to work to minimize it, and you really have to work on the automation side. Now, we have a few things that help us. Our infrastructure is entirely Debian, except when it's not, but we have like 1 or 2 machines that are not. And the ones that are not are specifically made to be different, because you want them to behave differently, to do some testing and things like that. We're currently entirely on Debian Jesse. We started this, when we started building out this infrastructure, we were running on Debian Lenny. We never actually got to deploy that in production. It went immediately to Squeeze, then Wheezy, and now on Jesse. We use a custom configuration management, so we don't use something like Puppet or Chef or Ansible. Part of it is because when we started doing this, they all sucked. They suck a lot less now. We can, you know, spend some time over beer discussing how they still suck. But, you know, all software sucks, especially the one that I wrote, right? But we have an advantage in this because we only run one thing. Right? Everything is Debian and Jesse, which means our problem is a lot simpler than if you have a heterogeneous environment. So we're basically reducing the scope enough that we run this. Most of everything is deployed using Debian packages. So we have a lot of custom Debian packages that control and configure things. And then we have a very small, I think the whole thing runs off just like 1,000 lines of Python code or something that actually drives all the automation, which is a lot less than just, say, the Puppet code we'd have to write. And on top of that, we'd have to actually run Puppet. So it's lightweight. And it's almost fully automated. It's to the point that if I needed to deploy, say, a new web front end for our system, I can probably done it in about 10 to 15 minutes, assuming there is a free IP address is actually the most difficult thing to get for that. But if we want to deploy something that's completely new, there is still a bunch of manual work. We deal with that, and we can live with that. So the challenge that leads us into this study is this new thing where we're saying, you know, we need to encrypt everything. You start getting into problems like, even if you know, we have a bunch of like small side-loaded websites that are really not that important, but if you don't do HTTPS, it's getting worse and worse, and you're gonna get to the point that the browser is gonna scream at you if you go to a non-HTTPS website. Right? It's happening, whether it makes sense or not, it's happening. So we have to deal with that. But we also have things like SMTP. If your SMTP sessions to Google, for example, are not TLS secured, then they're going to put a warning on the recipient's email. And when you try to send an email to this domain, they're going to give them a warning saying, hey, last time we spoke to these guys, they weren't encrypted. Are you sure you want to do this? And we'd really like not to do that. And of course, being the Postgres project, we have a bunch of Postgres connections. We have lots of services, and they all need to be secured one way or another. Now, there's a limit. Some of these are public services, like the main website or the public Git server, things like that. Some of them are internal services. Some of them are purely internal to the infrastructure where just the machines talk to each other. That's easy to solve. Like, we don't need to do anything about that. But we have the semi-public ones where, say, there is a central Git server that you can't get to, that only the people who are committers can get to that server and do things with that server. But these people are on their own machines. Like, we don't control the endpoints of anything. So these are typical cases where it's actually a little bit troublesome, particularly to deal with certificate management. For things that are entirely internal, if you're a big enterprise company, you have an internal CA, internal certificates, and you're good because you control the endpoints. And then you have your public website where you buy one certificate and you go for it and you're done. But all these sort of semi-services makes it a little harder. And we're, even the company sites are today, like, few companies have one website, at least if they're an IT company. They have lots of services, and then they have things that are running somewhere else, and it snowballs. The way we used to do this in, you know, the dark ages of over a year ago, it's like ages ago in internet time, we used to do this manually. We had individual service certificates, like most people do. We happen to have deals with some people who issue certificates, so we don't have to pay for them. Because, you know, they run on Postgres, they give us certificates, works out fine. But it's still manual issuing. Like, you have to go on their website, you have to fill out the details, you get a certificate, and then it expires. And then you have to go back on their website, and you have to fill out the details again, and you get a renewal, and deploying, and all that stuff. So that was kind of annoying. So to work around that, we helped a little bit. We had a wildcard certificate that they gave us as well, for start@postgres.org. But of course, that only covered postgres.org. But we also have postgres.eu and a bunch of other domains. They weren't covered under that. They were still manual. And this certificate was still manually renewed. And now we have the problem of shared secret keys, because this certificate has one private key that has to go on all the servers. That's not very good from a security perspective. Like, we're not supposed to do that. I go through all this, and we are small compared to many others. I actually, unrelated to this talk and unrelated to the work I was doing there, I was visiting a customer a couple of weeks ago. They actually had a full-time employee whose sole job was to ensure that their certificates got renewed on time. The full-time position. Now, compared to the cost of not renewing the certificates on time, that might actually make perfect sense, but it's also kind of frightening that this guy spent his whole workday just going through things and making sure that certificates were renewed. And of course, then they were renewed, and the CA that someone signed up for 5 years ago and bought them didn't exist anymore, so now they have to get a new one from a different CA, and it gets complicated. And the bigger the organization, the bigger the challenge. Right? If I just run my one web server for my own homepage, it's not a huge problem, but I still have multiple host names. So it's not actually a zero problem. So this worked as long as we only really cared about the main website and, you know, any website processing payments or passwords and made everything else HTTP. But we can't do that anymore. So it's no more. So the solution, or at least a solution to a problem like this, we could have hired a person. That doesn't really work when you don't have any money. We could have asked for volunteers. Nobody's going to volunteer to be the certificate maintainer. Like, wouldn't you want to put that on your resume? Like, for 5 years, I renewed certificates. It was so much fun. So for this, enter ACME, right? ACME can be a lot of things. In this context, it's the Automatic Certificate Management Environment, as it's called in the RFC. It's a standardized protocol. And the important part here is automatic. I like automatic. It means I don't have to do this myself. At least I don't have to do it once. I have to set up the automation, but then it works. Now, a lot of people who may not know what ACME is know of the most visible and common use case of this, which is LetsEncrypt. LetsEncrypt is one implementer of ACME. As far as I know, it's the only, at least the only large public implementer of ACME. But there's really no reason you can't use ACME within an organization for your private CA as well, for example. It's a standardized protocol. So LetsEncrypt is a CA, like, you know, VeriSign or Thought or Komodo or any of those. They issue certificates. And LetsEncrypt issues domain-validated certificates. Today we have two levels of certificates, right? We have domain-validated certificate, where the CA, I'm going to say, is supposed to validate that you own the domain that you're given a certificate for. If that actually worked, then, you know, people wouldn't be able to get certificates for google.com without being Google, and we know this has happened, right? So they're hackable, but that's maybe not a technical hack, but at least an administrative hack. Then we have these EV, or Enhanced Validation Certificate, where the CA is supposed to check that not only do you own company.com, you're actually a representative of the company. And that's much harder. In particular, it's really hard to automate this. It would probably be at least theoretically possible to automate this within Sweden, if you only allowed limited companies like ABs, because then there is a registry, you can look up contact info in, but that doesn't really work that way. So there's a lot of manual work there. LetsEncrypt just doesn't do EV. They only do domain validated. But they do domain validated, and that's what we had before, right? These free certificates they gave us were still domain validated, and the vast majority of all certificates on the internet today are domain validated, because that solves most of the problem. And the thing that LetsEncrypt does using this ACME protocol is it's fully automated validation. Who remembers the old days when the way you got a certificate was you had to send a fax to VeriSign on company letterhead paper in order to get the certificate? And if your company didn't have letterhead paper, you just made some up and you sent it in and it worked. That's like the I think that still worked in the early 2000s. You could still do that, which is kind of interesting. But you had to send it on fax, which is why it doesn't work anymore, because you can't find a fax to send. I'm sure VeriSign has a fax to receive them on. The thing that LetsEncrypt do differently is they issue all their certificates with a validity of 90 days. So not 1 year, not 2 or 5 years, 90 days. What that means is if you're using LetsEncrypt, you have to automate, right? And that's intentional. You can't really get around to doing it manually every 90 days, because then you have 100 certificates, you're doing more than one certificate a day on average. That just doesn't scale. Not to mention if you have 1,000. So they do that, but of course they make it possible to automate the renewal as well, which is kind of the whole point. It also means they don't really have to care as much about certificate revocation. You can revoke certificates, but if you just lose your keys, then you can't actually revoke it either. Doesn't really matter, it expires after 90 days and then it's not valid anymore. So it helps to work around a couple of problems. Now LetsEncrypt ships with a client. It's called CertBot. that's the default client, and it works really simple. Don't you love my graphic skills, Ron? I should hire a graphical person somewhere else. You can tell I'm a technical person, right? So basically, you have this SERP button. What it does is the SERP button makes an API call to Let's Encrypt, their web service on the internet, and says, hey, give me a certificate for web.domain.com. Let's Encrypt will respond saying, here's a challenge. Here's a big bunch of random data. Put this big bunch of random data on your web server in a directory called .wellknown with a file name like this. And then Let's Encrypt will ping that URL and ensure that this secret nonce shows up. And that's how you prove that this is your website. Right? You take the magic you get from here, you put it on your website, they verify it, and once they've done that, they at least know that, okay, the person or the script that's trying to get a certificate has control of the web server. Now, whether that, if it's a hacker who controls the web server, then they can get a certificate for the hacked web server. That's domain validation. Once they verify that, they issue the certificate back to CertBot, and CertBot will deploy it. So the idea behind CertBot is you just say, oh, here's my Apache website, CertBot, give me a certificate, and you wait for a minute, and your website is now HTTPS. You don't do anything else. That's the general idea behind CertBot. There are a couple of problems with it. It requires exposed HTTP services. So this poll here is always HTTP. What if my web server is behind a firewall? They don't even publish a list of which IP addresses they're going to make the verification from, because they reserve the right to change that quickly, and they don't want people to block them because of that. So a firewall will kill them. What if I'm getting a certificate for a mail server? That doesn't really work. And it also tries to automatically configure the web server. I think that's scary. Very, very scary. Like, it edits your Apache config and restarts Apache. And does this whole, and then it edits it again to enable SSL and restarts it again for you. Now, in fairness, there is a lot of smart logic in CertBot. As long as you haven't done anything funny with your config from the default on your platform, it probably works. Most of the time. It still scares me. Right? I just don't like that. In particular, a lot of the times when I've configured my web servers, the config doesn't exactly look like the standard anymore. And that means this might just randomly break. I've seen this randomly break. And in particular, I don't want this done in an automated way. I mean, I use this fine for my personal website where I can sit and look at it, and I got 1 minute of downtime to revert the changes. That's not really a big problem, but you don't want to do this in a distributed fashion. At least I don't want to do this in a distributed fashion. CertBot can do a few other things. You can tell it to run in manual mode and just say, I'm going to edit the config files myself. That's much safer, but then it's not automated anymore. But we can plug these things in. But the thing about CertBot that a lot of people miss when they consider Let's Encrypt is that CertBot is just a client. The protocol that CertBot speaks to Let's Encrypt is ACME, and it's an open protocol. Right? It's a standardized protocol. You don't have to use CertBot. CertBot is just the client. ACME also supports multiple ways to verify. So it doesn't just have to be an HTTP ping. CertBot only supports HTTP ping because it's easiest. But there are there are at least two others, so that's 200% more options that are in the protocol. For example, you can use TLS SNI, so it can connect to an existing TLS certificate and use SNI over that. I've never used that, but it can, to validate that you own the domain. But it also supports, the one that we are using is called ACME DNS 01, which means instead of putting these files on our web server, we put a text record in DNS. And if I own the DNS for PostgreSQL.org, then presumably I own the domain. Like, if I can hack the DNS, then I can repoint the web server anyway and fake that proof as well. And I'd say the DNS one is a lot more suitable for a centralized management, because probably your DNS is already centralized managed. If it isn't, then wow. That can be kind of annoying, but since you probably have it, it's a good starting point. Now, the basics of how it works is very similar. But the difference here is, of course, the manager will take this secret key, and instead of pushing it to the web server, it'll push it to DNS. And Let's Encrypt will then go talk to DNS. So when I say issue my certificate for Postgres.org, it goes look up these special secret keys in a text record in DNS. And if it's there, it issues the certificate, and we publish it again. And of course, one of the big advantages of this is there's no longer an arrow pointing from Let's Encrypt to my website. Let's Encrypt never pings my website. I don't have to have HTTP. I don't have to have firewalls open. I don't have to have any of that. Instead, I have an outbound connection where I somehow update my DNS to publish this proof. Of course, this fixes that problem and gives us a whole new set of problems. But that's kind of, you know, the whack-a-mole of IT. This gives us a centralized key distribution with all our private keys sitting on this manager up here. That's not really good for security. Now, that's similar to what we already had with our wildcard certificate, right? But we all said that's not very good, so we can fix that. Or it requires a distributed access to DNS, where each server can update its own DNS record. Now, this you can actually do. Just make sure you do it right so that, you know, server 1 does not have permission to update the DNS record for server 2, sort of in general. And then it becomes complicated instead. But if you have a dynamic DNS environment where you then, if I'm server 1 and I control server1.domain.com, then the proof is going to be something.server1.domain.com. So as long as I sort of do the sub-domain control there, it can be done with distributed access to DNS. But that becomes complicated. So let's take a step back and look at this. So how did we actually do this? We look again at Postgres.org, at the case study of these things. We do have this existing simple config management. And hopefully, if you have 15 plus machines in your environment, you have some sort of config management. Whether it's 10 bash scripts you wrote yourself, or, you know, it's Ansible, but you have something. If not, you should really look at having something. We have a central API. We have a little API endpoint that is already client certificate authenticated, that uses the fact that as long as we only speak internally, it's easy. Because we have a little CA where every server gets an internal certificate. This is similar to, for example, if you run Puppet in your environment, there is a CA in Puppet that does exactly that to ensure communication security between our servers. So we can just leverage this. And as I say, make it a proper like enterprise solution by adding lots and lots of arrows to the graph. So basically, we have our virtual machine. So when we get a certificate, and this is basically how it looks in Postgres.org today, when a virtual machine wants a certificate, it'll ping this management endpoint and upload a CSR. Or actually, what happens is every time it knows, it says, hey, which certificates am I supposed to have? And if it doesn't have it, then it generates a CSR. So it's not even a manual process where we go in and say, give me a certificate now. There's a list that says, for this server, these certificates should exist. So it'll go in and generate a CSR. It'll upload this to the API management, which stores it in a central database. This happens every 5 minutes on each machine. It checks whether there are any new certificates to be processed. And then basically we have this Let's Encrypt integrator step that just pulls the database saying, are there any CSR, any certificate signing requests in this database that haven't been issued? Or are there any that are about to expire? These are treated similarly. And when that happens, this guy will update DNS. We already have a central DNS I think we have 4 different distributed servers. We have DNSSEC deployed across the domain and all that stuff. So all that already exists. So this guy just needs to publish these magic records to DNS. Then this one will make a call to Let's Encrypt saying, give me the certificate for this domain that I just published all the secrets for. It gets the certificate back and it stores it in the database. And then it's done. And then at the next of these 5 minute runs that happens on the virtual machine, it'll go ping up here and say, hey, you know, I asked for the certificate. Do you have it for me yet? And if it has the certificate, well, it gets dropped onto the VM again, gets deployed. And yes, we do automatically restart the web server because our web server config is already under control of this config management tool. It knows what it looks like. We can also just deploy it if we don't have a plugin for the web server that's running or the mail server that's running or something, then we just drop the certificate on the machine and you have to go configure it manually. Because that only happens when a new certificate is done. So the way this looks in reality is whenever I want to deploy a new service, I go on our central management web. For anyone who's ever seen it, yes, it's a simple Django app. This is the Django backend web interface. And I'll just give it a primary. In this case, this is test host with Postgres.org. You can give it secondary names. I think LetsEncrypt supports up to 200 secondary domain names or host names on each certificate. You probably don't have that many. Then we pick which server is it going to go on, and we can put comment on it if we want, and just save that. And that's basically all that I have to do manually. Then I, you know, go get another coffee. I wait a while. I come back. The certificate is now on the machine. If it happens to be running one of our standardized web servers, it'll be live in HTTPS. What happens if you look at the log on this VM? This is actually, I didn't end up creating a test host at Postgres.org. I just used the real one for this. But basically, you can see it runs, this is the PG infra, which is our job, a complete user and package check, and then it says creating certificate request 4. That's when it detected that I had gone into the web interface, I've added a certificate, the node didn't know about it, so it creates a CSR. That means the key is generated on the node, it's on the VM. The key is not central at any point. It's generated on the VM, it generates a certificate signing request, and it uploads it to the central management interface. Then we have the job that runs on the central server. Normally we don't run it with /letsencrypt cron, it actually runs in, well, cron. Which we'll look, and it, you can see it starts by saying, you know, getting challenges for one identifier and setting up for one remaining challenge. There's one challenge for each host. So if it might be generating 10 certificates, then it sets up 10 challenges, does all of them in parallel. So at this point, it updates the DNS server. It publishes all of these secrets in DNS and flushes that out. Of course, we all know the thing, when you update DNS, how long does it take for it to become active? Well, yes, you never quite know. Now what Let's Encrypt does is, they don't cache, and they promise they don't cache themselves. They will always hit your authoritative DNS servers, but you probably have more than one. In our case, we have a blind primary and 4 actual authoritative web servers. DNS servers. Each of those DNS servers has an IPv4 and an IPv6 address. So we need to publish and make sure they're on all of them. So we publish this on the central one. And then we actually pull just the number. We started, we had 8, now we're down to 4. And we pull our own DNS servers to wait until our record is on all of them. That's not something we have to do, but assume we called Let's Encrypt at this point when it's hit half of our DNS servers, and Let's Encrypt happens to hit another one, the proof isn't there. Now we can try again with Let's Encrypt, but they have a much longer timeout before we can actually try again. So this is just to make sure that once we call Let's Encrypt, we know that the proof is there. So we keep looping until there's nothing left, until all records are present. And it comes back to waiting for the one challenge, means we call Let's Encrypt, saying, we've proven this now, give us our certificate. And then again, we loop and wait for Let's Encrypt. In theory, that can take time. I don't think it's ever taken like more than one API call, but you can get an API response that says, yeah, we're working on it, hold on. And then you just have to wait there. And that's the problem. When we ran in tests and didn't do this step, then this step had much longer waiting times because they pulled once, it wasn't there, and then it hit the back of the queue somewhere at Let's Encrypt, and it took a while for them to do that because, you know, they issue many millions of certificates. When you're at the back of the queue, well, sorry. And once that's done, it issues the certificate, which in this case, for this central server, just means downloading it from Let's Encrypt, storing it in the database. And if we go back looking at this, it actually just shows up here. So this one was issued on September 21, you can tell when I did that one. And it expires on December 20th, which is 90 days later. So we just keep track of those, and they go in the central database. So when the next time, again, the VM comes back, instead of issuing a CSR, it notices it's there. It says downloading certificate. In this case, this is our Lighty integration, so it puts the certificate, nice little cutoff. One is the certificate, one is the key, to the web server. And it actually restarts the service. That's because we have a plugin that knows how to deal with Lighty. We run a couple of Apache servers, we don't actually have a plugin for that. In that case, it'll just download the certificate, it will only run this stuff. And everything after that, the admin will just have to do manually. So we try to avoid being in that position. And at this point, we've really solved those two issues, right? Our keys stay on the VM, because the key is generated here, but only the CSR is uploaded. The key is never distributed. And given that these are certificates that are so cheap to get new, if something happens to this machine, like, we don't need to back up the key, we'll just generate a new one. This is really simple in that regard. We don't have to expose any services. None of them, LetsEncrypt never talks to anything up here. And as a bonus, we have an audit trail of all the certificates. We don't audit the keys because keys are dangerous, but the certificate is public information. So we get a full audit trail of every certificate in the entire organization just goes in this long list. And we do actually, the way it is now, we keep every certificate forever, even the expired ones. Just in case we'd have to do some sort of forensics or anything. Because with 100 VMs and a new certificate every 90 days, it takes a long time for that to actually get to a lot of certificates. If you're an organization with 100,000 host names, 100,000 certificates, then maybe you don't want to keep them all forever. Or maybe you do. You have the options. Right. So what does this actually look like? The code is surprisingly simple. There is an ACME Python module. This is what CertBot uses. Right? Unfortunately, at least when we checked this, last checked it a couple of months ago, the released version of the ACME Python module did not support the DNS thing. You had to run off Git. But so does CertBot. So CertBot themselves don't use the released version of the ACME module that they wrote themselves. But they pull in the Git head into the CertBot and make a release of that. So we just picked a version that was the same one that CertBot used in a release, and that worked fine. Of course, this leaves us, the CertBot code is in Python. That's one of the, and our management code was already in Python. These are two good reasons to write our integration in Python. There are ACME modules in other languages than Python. There is Perl modules, there's, I think I've seen a Ruby module, there's probably a JavaScript module. There's probably one for almost everything. If there isn't, you should write one. And of course, we use OpenSSL because, you know, we love to patch every Tuesday. In fact, we already have OpenSSL everywhere because we're a Linux infrastructure. And OpenSSL has decent Python bindings. Because we still need to create our keys. We still need to create our CSR. We need actual SSL or X509 features to do that. And you really don't want to build that features yourself. Again, OpenSSL is there. So if we look at the simplest part, if you've never seen Python, this may look a little bit confusing. It's a cut-down version, but the general idea of how we do this, this is the sync public certificate is run every 5 minutes, this thing. And it gets a list, which in the cert data, gets a list of which certificates are needed on this machine. And basically, if the CSR needed flag is set, that means this machine is supposed to have a certificate, and it doesn't even have a certificate request, let alone a certificate. In that case, we generate, this is the OpenSSL binding, so we generate a private key of 4,096 bits. We generate a X509 request, set the CN of the subject to the hostname, because that's how we're supposed to do it for the web at least, and we do it for everything. Then if you have more than one name, you add an extension called subject alternate name, and you put all your secondary names in there with a comma in between and a DNS prefix. So it will be DNS colon server1.domain.com, comma DNS colon server2.domain.com. You have to put DNS at every one of them. I got that wrong initially, and that doesn't work. Because then it becomes an invalid certificate. We set the version to 2. We set the public key. We sign it with SHA-256, because that's what Let's Encrypt uses, so why not just use the same? Nothing more really makes sense. And then we just say dump certificate request and store that back in the CSR data. At the end of this, when the whole loop is run, that CSR data, if there's anything in it, gets automatically uploaded to the central server. So this is basically how much code you need to generate the key and the certificate request. There's a small part missing here, which is, of course, we have to take this private key and actually write it to disk on the VM. Because if we get a CSR and then we lose the private key, then that CSR is completely worthless. Let's Encrypt will still give us a certificate. We can't use it. In theory, you could, if you really care about it, you could have ephemeral keys and ephemeral certificates, which means every time you reboot, you get a new certificate. I wouldn't necessarily recommend that, but you can, and it works. And if we then look at the core of the central integration, well, I told you I was a database guy, right? I'm going to show you some SQL. You're not getting away from that. But this is basically, this is how we query our database. This will give us back a list of primary names, secondary names, and CSR for every certificate or for every host that has a certificate that has not been issued or a certificate that's older than 60 days. So we start the renewal process after 60 days because we only have 30 days for it to complete before problems start showing up. And we run this thing every hour. So that means we get a fair number of chances to try to renew a certificate. But you don't want to do the renewal, you know, the day before it expires, because Let's Encrypt might be down. I think I've seen this cron job fail twice in half a year because Let's Encrypt was unavailable. It happens, right? There could be a small network glitch. So don't push it too short. We figured, you know, 2/3 of the way through, 1 month to renew, we'll be okay. We'll even have time to fix it manually if it breaks at that point, which is kind of important. We just loop over those and generate our own Let's Encrypt issuer, which is our little wrapper to talk to Let's Encrypt. And of course, if there is nothing to do, then we just exit. We don't do anything. What happens then is we take all the identifiers. So an identifier is everything that we need to prove. In theory, we could have be issuing 3 different certificates, all having, you know, www.postgres.org in the name. If we do that, then we only need to prove our ownership of www.postgres.org once. So this one just takes that, turns it into a set, which makes it unique. That's how you make a unique entry in Python. Then we talk to Let's Encrypt and we say, give me the challenges for all these identifiers. That means for every one of the things that we need to prove, our host name or our secondary names, we get these random data blocks back from Let's Encrypt saying, okay, to prove that you own server1.domain.com, this is the magic knots that you need to publish. So we get that back for all of them. And then we basically loop over them and add them to DNS. So we do this challenge here comes from the ACME client and says, get the DNS name and get DNS contents. So that'll give us, so what's the host name that we're, or the record name that we're supposed to publish and what we're going to put in the text record. And then we put them there. In our case, doing this is pretty simple. Our blind primary DNS server is PowerDNS, running on a Postgres backend, because, you know, we're Postgres. But the important thing is it runs on a database backend. So to add these records, we just insert a row in the table. And once we've done that, when we're done with all of it, we say flush challenges, which will update the serial number of the zone and do the DNSSEC signing of the zone. If you don't have automated DNSSEC signing, if you have manual DNSSEC signing, this is not going to work. Because then you're going to go in there and do it manual for every time. But yeah, that one basically just updates serials and sets that thing. And once at that point, we end up just looping over this check records. That's the part that pulls our 4 servers are on our 8 IP addresses and says, are these records out there yet? Are these records out there yet? Even though we update them immediately and we push them out from this blind primary, it still takes a little bit of a while. When bind gets, hey, update this zone, it doesn't actually update it immediately. It updates it pretty quickly. But all in all, this can take like a minute before it spreads out across everything. And it behaves slightly different because, of course, we have 4 DNS servers. They're not all running the same DNS server software. We're running different pieces of, but I think we're running 3 different ones on different nodes. Just, you know, because we can and because you're not supposed to run the one thing if it fails. If someone finds a security issue in it, we can just shut that down and we still have other DNS servers running. So once we have gone through this loop here, which is basically, you know, how many DNS records are left? If there are no DNS records left, break, just stop looping. If there are anything left, sleep for 30 seconds, then pull them all again. Once all our DNS records are in place, we can go back and we do something called answer challenge. That's also part of the ACME client and the ACME protocol. So we got all these magic numbers, and answer challenge is basically we tell Let's Encrypt that, okay, I have published this now. And I tell them which one. So they give me the challenge saying, you can publish this in DNS or you can publish it on HTTP at this address. And my answer challenge will just say, okay, well, I published it in DNS now. Go check it for me, please. So we answer all of our challenges at once. There are some limits to Let's Encrypt. You're not allowed to do that for more than like a few hundred at the same time. We just say we're never going to have that many. That's easier. And then we loop on the second loop waiting for Let's Encrypt. So the LE client, Let's Encrypt, remaining challenges, specifying true, which tells Let's Encrypt to, yes, go check it again, if you haven't already. And the same thing here, we just loop, we sleep for 30 seconds, because there's really no point in pulling, like, we don't need that quick responses, we just need automatic responses. It's okay if they take a minute to get there. Once all the challenges have been handled by Let's Encrypt, then we just loop over them and say issue for each one of these issuer. Now, when you issue a certificate, you get back a certificate, a chain, and an expire state. That's one thing that I screwed up initially in writing this, is I kind of assumed that Let's Encrypt would use the same issuing certificates. For example, when you renew a certificate, and they don't. So you really need to update the chain along with the certificate every time. Because they rotate their own certificates, not every 90 days, but they still rotate them quite often. In my case, they rotated it the day after I put this thing in production and everything broke. So I managed to like issue for two servers on the first day, then on the second day when I was going to do the third server, nothing worked. And that turned out because I had hard-coded the chain, because I figured that changed along with the issuer, but it doesn't. So it changes very often. So what we do here is we just insert it into our Let's Encrypt issued certificate table and write all three of these into this table. And don't forget this part, which is remove all the records from DNS again. So eventually your DNS will be very, very big. And same thing if you're using this on files, make sure you delete the old files. Once this has been proven, you're not going to use the same proof ever again. If you need to prove the same hostname again, you're going to get a new secret key. So you're not going to be reusing them anyway, so let's just get rid of them. And at this point, we have our certificates, and we're good to go. The next step is, of course, the certificate deployment. Again, in our case, we just download them on the next sync, and what the core code just does is it puts them in the standard Debian directory, so etc. SSL certs and etc. SSL private. And it puts the correct permissions on it, and then it doesn't do anything else. And then it's really, at that point, it's up to the config management part of these tools. And our config management knows, again, about some of the things that we know. It knows about some of our web servers. So we have plugins for Lighty, we have plugins for HAProxy. We don't have plugins for Apache. We have plugins for XM, for email, which is what we use. So if we have a plugin, then we can automatically generate it. The thing that's really important for this one to know is the order of certificates and keys and chains and things, how you put that tends to be different in all of them. It's amazing how you only have three things and you can still find like 100 different ways of putting them in files. But whether should the key come before the certificate or not, some care, some don't care, some want them in the same file, some want them in different files. And don't forget to restart. We had a really interesting case where I think the issue was with our Lighty servers where we issued a restart and it said it restarted, but it didn't actually restart, so it didn't pick up the new certificate, even though it was there. Because the restart had somehow lost track of the running version of Lighty. I don't know how that happened. I still don't know how that happened. But we managed to get around that by restarting in a different way. So the core of what these plugins actually look like is something like this. So this is the HAProxy plugin. So it loops over all the public certificates. And basically it reads, so this will show you the things that came out. It will read certificate, the key, and the chain from the standard directory. So first, step one, the core code writes them all down there. Step two, the plugins reads them back. It also reads back the DH params, because HAProxy needs all of these four things to be in the same file. And then it writes those up into, etc., HAProxy cert files, listing all of them one by one. And then the way these plugins work here is they just takes the content, writes it, and says, if this file changed, then restart HAProxy. It does that automatically. It's very simple for something like HAProxy, which has very little state, so we can actually do a restart. There are some other cases where you might not want to do a restart, like when we deploy a certificate for our database servers. You don't necessarily want to restart the database server just like that. You lose all your cache, you lose all your running sessions, that's not really a problem, but HAProxy serving up web requests, restarting is really not a problem. So that handles those things automated all the way through. Certificate renewal, though, that's, as we said, that's the bigger problem, right? In ACME and in LetsEncrypt, certificate renewal is just the same as reissue. They don't really implement renewal as a separate process. Technically, renewal is not a separate process, but traditional CAs often have it as a separate process because of how the manual routines work, if you already have it and all that stuff. So you just prove again that you are this. Like, every proof you have will be valid for a certain amount of time. When that time expires, you just prove it again. You run exactly the same thing again. There's no special handling. The only way that LetsEncrypt treat them differently is there is a different rate limit on how many of them that you are allowed to do within a certain period of time. Because LetsEncrypt does have limits. You can't just pound them out for a million certificates every day. They allow you for each account, now you can create multiple accounts, they don't really care about that, but they allow you to issue 20 new certificates per domain per week. That's completely new certificates. Renewals don't count. And each certificate can have 100 names in it. So if you are running a web server with 100 virtual hosts on it, you could either have 100 certificates or just one certificate with 100 names on it. This is clearly to direct you towards have one certificate with 100 names on it, and then use SNI. That works for everything except like really old versions of Java or really old versions of Android, probably because really old versions of Android run really old versions of Java, almost Java. Tends not to be a problem. Since we started doing this, we've not had a single person complain about LetsEncrypt as a CA not being in their browser or being in whatever software they're using to communicate. Not one. You can issue 5 duplicate certificates per week, which is something to be slightly careful about when you're building this automation. They have a test environment that doesn't have that limit. Because that's if the certificate is completely identical. You can't generate a new one with exactly the same host names in it more than 5 times a week. You can't make more than 500 new certificates from the same IP in 3 hours. So again, for someone like us, that's not really a problem. And you can't have more than 300 pending authorizations. So that's 300 host names being given certificates at the same time without waiting for the first one to finish. In fairness, I'll say these numbers may have been updated. They update them every now and then. They might be higher now. The point for us is, for us, we're nowhere near these limits, right? By a long shot. And most people aren't. If you are, you can actually contact LetsEncrypt and ask them to raise the limit for you. And they're known to do that for some organizations. Like, if you're a big cloud provider who are getting certificates for your customers, for example, you might hit these limits. They'll lift the limits for you. They're just the default limits. So as conclusions, what we managed to get to this was something that's a hell of a lot easier than what we had before. We really are at pretty much close to zero to deploy new SSL or TLS-based services. We are at zero work for maintenance and renewal. We don't do anything. Every now and then there's an email dropped in a mailbox saying, oh hey, we just renewed 4 certificates for you, everything's good. That's pretty much all we need. And we ended up with better security than we had before. Some people are saying, you know, we went to LetsEncrypt, but you know, even though it's slightly less secure, how is it less secure? I think the existing CAs have very well proven that they're not very secure. At least not for domain validated certificates. They've also, many of them have proven they're not really secure for the enhanced validation certificates either. But for domain validated, I'd say Let's Encrypt is probably more secure. And in our case, we also no longer have shared keys across the infrastructure. Keys are individual, so we don't run the risk of losing, like actually losing the keys for a wildcard cert for your entire domain is not good. Especially when that cert is valid for 3 or 5 years. That's actual value that you lose. With the Let's Encrypt, again, it's gone in 90 days. And it's individual. In my experience doing this, like initially we only started doing it as a proof of concept to see if it could even be done. It turned out to be really easy. Like, can this be done? At the end of the day, oh, it's already done now. Okay, so it could be done. It really was that it's only a couple of hours work to get the basics up and running. Then the actual integration with like Lighty and NJ proxy actually took more time than making Let's Encrypt work. But don't forget to monitor the expiry. Hopefully you're doing that today. I know you're not, but you should be. Monitoring the expiry of all your HTTPS certificates. We did that on the old ones, and then we figured at some point when we deployed all the new services, we didn't automatically deploy monitoring. And then we had this bug where it didn't properly restart the web server. So the certificate actually expired, even though the new certificate was on disk. We just needed a restart. So now we automatically also deploy Nagios monitors that will alert us when there is, I think the alert hits 14 days before it expires. So 30 days before it expires, we start trying to renew it with the automated process. If that hasn't finished or completed 14 days before, we get a critical alert. Or I guess at 14 days, we probably get a warning alert in Nagios, and then like 7 days, we get a critical alert. Don't forget that step. These monitors are important, and especially if you're not using this automated, if you're doing this manually today, then really, you need to put expiry monitoring on them probably yesterday. An interesting thing, if you look at that, if you look at stats for like mail servers, this is a ridiculously large percentage of the mail servers on the internet who run with expired certificates. Because there's no browser to give you a warning, so nobody phones up and says, hey, your website's broken. But if you actually look at the numbers, I think Google has done some study because they send crap tons of email, and it's a large number of them that are expired. They shouldn't be. It's more important on the web server certificates, but they really should never be. Okay, that's what I had. Thank you very much for paying attention. I think we have just under 5 minutes for questions, if we have any.
Who is behind Let's Encrypt? Is it a company?
Who's behind Let's Encrypt? It's a foundation. There's a number of companies and organizations backing them, including, I think, FSF is behind them, and EFF at least, the Electronic Frontier Foundation, and some large companies who are putting money in there, because they're costing to the tune of $1 million a year or something for Let's Encrypt to run all their infrastructure that we get to use for free. I think browsers like Mozilla, I think, backs them, and Google and the browser makers, because they got sick and tired of the other CAs blocking their work, basically.
This difference between HTTP and DNS. In your graphics, it looked like you started to update the DNS, and then you contacted Let's Encrypt. But your code seems
that
you actually get the challenge about both cases.
Yeah, that's a slight oversimplification. So The order is you contact Let's Encrypt twice.
Yeah.
First you contact them and ask them for the secret key.
In both cases. Okay.
Then you publish it somewhere. Then you contact them again saying, I've now published the secret key.
Okay. So
and then they go verify it.
It's
so
the same process.
It's the same process, yes. And you have to do that in both cases.
Okay.
Well then, thank you very much for attending, and enjoy the rest of the day.
Testa nu om det verkligen blir inspelat nu i 4 minuter.
You're up next.